What we're trying to do is save time, especially now, June 2013. So, let us look at the stumbling blocks and see if we can't find a way to leverage the whole situation so we save all time. And how do we save time? By realizing we're not in time. How is it that we're not in time? Because time has never started. How is it that time has never started? Because there's no such thing as time. What we are doing is we are simulating what it would be like if we were in time. We are training in a simulation of time to prepare to actually step into time. So the truth is we're not in time, which is a very strange situation for us because we believe that we are. So what I would suggest is we take a fresh look at our perspective. And in time, we're tired, we're sick, all these problems, quote unquote, in time, in the simulation of time. We're going through all this struggle. I would suggest to, rather than struggle with all that, to look back at the original root choice and to choose, instead of a simulation of time, a simulation of no time, of timelessness, a simulation of preparing to step into timelessness, and to choose that instead of choosing to, the simulation of time. At which point, it would seem that we would then experience the simulation of timelessness or the preparation to step into timelessness. Even though timelessness itself also is a hypothetical, it doesn't exist. Neither time nor timelessness exists. They're both imaginary. But we are so used to simulation and preparation that we don't want to drop it. So we need the continuity. For the sake of continuity, we want to continue to simulate and prepare. So what we do is we choose the simulation of timelessness and we choose to use that to prepare to step into timelessness. So what is the simulation of timelessness? How do we prep for that? That's what we need to find out. That's what we need to choose. And in choosing that, we leave all of the simulation of time and everything that we were simulating and training for, all our prep, unresolved. We don't need to resolve on any of it. We don't need to figure out how to gain energy. We don't need to figure out how to be healed from an illness. We don't need to figure out what to do about death, the afterlife, problems, interpersonal problems, survival, everything. We don't need to have any answers for that. We can drop the demand for answers. Because after all this is only prepping. It's how we imagine we need to prep for time. We don't know how to prep for time because there's no such thing as time. So we're imagining that this is what we need time to be for us. So we're prepping for that. So we leave all of that unresolved. And as if it were, we step into a miracle. That's one way to put it. That's just a term, you know, but you could use such a term. We step into something that doesn't need to resolve the other thing at all. It's a complete idea. It's a complete simulation in itself, a complete prepping in itself. So there is no answer to how did you get well? How did you go from fatigue to energy? How did you do this? You didn't go from this to that. There are no answers for it. You simply exchange one prepping for another prepping. Prepping with a different purpose in mind. So now you feel bliss, you feel peace of mind. That's the prepping to step into timelessness. The prep to step into timelessness is bliss, is peace of mind, is joy, is overflowingness. That is the prep to step into timelessness. Now, we'll never step into timelessness, just like we'll never step into time. But what happens is, in prepping to step into timelessness, we then reach a point where we decide we don't need to prep for anything. We can just abide as we are, which is nothing and everything abiding within, residing within nothing and everything. So we drop all simulation and all prep altogether at that point, but we don't need to worry about getting there. What we need to do is accept this training, this simulation, to prepare us to step into timelessness. So that's how I see it. You see how it's a shortcut. We don't have to work on solving any problems of this simulation of time. Don't have to work on solving any of it whatsoever. We simply decide we're going to accept a simulation of timelessness, or for the purposes of training, to get ready to step into timelessness. And that simulation carries with it the peace beyond understanding, the bliss, the overflowingness of bliss. And it's and there's no explanation of, wait, now, what did I do, you know, with my genetic structure? What did I do with this? What did I do with that? How did I get more energy, more, you know, how did I balance the chakras, blah, blah. There's no explanation for it whatsoever, none, except for a choice. That's it. The only explanation is you chose to exchange the simulation of time for the simulation of timelessness. You chose to exchange the prepping for time for the prepping for timelessness. Just like that. It's all over. It's finished. So I would say that's a time saver. A huge time saver. If we can get to accepting that, and I feel I am working on it at least. Just like, it's an idea. It's like, wow, maybe I can do that. Maybe I can. Now, here's the important thing. All this, we hear about bliss and peace beyond understanding, all this stuff. It's important to note this is the prepping to step into timelessness. It's not the actual timelessness at all. Just like we're experiencing all those feelings now, we have depression, loneliness, alienation, fatigue, fear, uncertainty, instability, anger, you know, all this stuff. That's the part of the prepping for time. Where did it come from? It came from prepping for time. That's where it comes from. It arises because we're imagining this is what we need to prep for. So just like, where does the bliss, where does the peace come from? It comes from the prepping for timelessness. That's where it comes from. Simple. No more explanations are needed. It's imagination. Is it just our imagination that this is how we imagine timelessness to be? So we imagine this is how we need to prep for timelessness. Meaning completeness, no process, immediacy, isness. And so that just frees us from all these questions and answers. You see how that just frees you up from all the questions and answers, really, that we have been toiling under, like moving through a swamp, trying to explain, well, how do we explain ourselves? How do we explain this? And that we don't need to. We have a new explanation. So it's the new explanation that saves the time. The new explanation saves the time. And by accepting this new explanation, we can be there right now. It's terrific. Absolutely terrific. So, in my prepping for time, I feel terrible. Because, of course, we know catastrophes are coming. So, how can you really feel great if you're really into prepping for time? You're far along, you think, oh my gosh, I'm just about ready to step into the catastrophes. But you say no. You say, no, I decided to give up prepping for time and instead prep for timelessness. And then that should deliver the bliss that we've been looking for within our prepping for time. But you can never find bliss in prepping for time. No way, no how can you really find the true overflowing bliss. Now, I've been having a whole lot of feelings right here in the third eye area recently. It's going on right now. I don't know why. Just suddenly it's a strong sensation in this area of my forehead. And it keeps coming, and it kind of goes on, subsides, and then it comes again, and subsides like that. So, I don't know. Maybe it's just tension, maybe it's anxiety, maybe, who knows what it is, the times. So we need to save time. We cannot continue on our laborious way of just being bogged down with all these questions and struggling to answer all these numerous questions and thinking, okay, now how do I... it's just... It goes on and on and on and on and on. There's no end in sight. I can tell you when I look at my prepping for time, even with a spiritual twist to it, it goes on and on and on and on, and I don't see any end to it whatsoever, none. Whereas if I see, there's that third eye again, prepping for exchanging and decide to prep for timelessness, I get this sense that I could feel bliss right this moment. Just right now. I mean, it's that simple. It's just like picking something up and setting something down, or, you know, it's that simple, it's that quick. And of course, people would say, "What happened to you? What happened? What happened? Oh, wow, big transformation!" And then you think, "Oh, I have to explain it. You know, how did I? Did I elevate myself?" With, you know, and you get bogged down with how in the world can I explain this? But now I've given shared a tool here with everyone freely that gives you the tool to explain it. You said, "I just exchanged simulations. I'm prepping now for timelessness because I realized that." Neither time nor timelessness will ever start. And the only issue I have is a continuity issue with reality. So the prepping for timelessness solves the continuity issue for me, and that's it. People might say, huh? And then you can just repeat it. And say, it's as simple. And people say, I don't understand. Well, you can say, well, you're looking for some other answer. You know, this is the answer I have. But you're looking for some other answer, and I can't help you with that. I can only help you with, you know, the answer that I have. So it seems to be lifting a huge burden here, huge burden off of our backs. An impossible burden, really. I've struggled with it my entire life, trying to figure out how can I allow this, you know, this enlightenment, this bliss that's already there, we already know the truth, to how can I allow it to be here in the world, because people will plug it into their own spiritual paths and say, well, how does this fit to my path? Can you explain how my path can get to where you are? And I have to say, it doesn't. It doesn't. The real spiritual path is to be open to fresh insight, fresh clarity, of greater simplicity, and a greater totality, and a greater time-savingness, to be open to that instead of demanding that the path be what you want it to be, and say, no, it needs to be this and this and this and this, and that these terms have to use, and all this stuff. The real spiritual path is to be willing to let go of your preconceived notions and get a fresh perspective on it, because that's what saves time. And that's what actually works. So the perspective I have, the feeling I have now, is one of just tremendous simplicity and ease and non-difficulty. Because I will simply accept the bliss and say, well, this is just prepping for stepping on timelessness. I don't have to step yet. It's just prepping. I'm just prepping. So I can take as much time as I want to prepping, quote unquote, chronological time. I can stay with this as long as I want. I can just enjoy the bliss, and there's no hurry. I'm just prepping. Just prepping. There's no hurry. So there you go. And just abide in the bliss. Like Ramana said, just abide in the self. Abide in the bliss as prepping. You're just prepping to ultimately step into timelessness. But then you know, well, actually, I will drop prepping altogether at some point. So that's it. There's no complex explanation. So really the greatness of this way is to master the simple explanation and accept it. And that really takes you off the hook for everything else. Now, as usual in these videos, after I present the main theme like this, I'll go over it again and we'll spend some time. Because what's important is to let it take root. It's like you transplant a plant, push down the soil, and then water it, and give it some time to take root and get used to it before you inundate yourself with your schedule. You know, what are you going to do next? Because that quickly it fades. The clarity quickly fades when you get back into your routine. So even though you may have seen it, you say, I see what's being said here. Spend some time with it. Let me adjust my position here. Just okay. Just the very fact of seeing the stark simplicity of it is a mind blower. Because now, I want to point this out. Very important. Because occasionally people have like a negative reaction, and that's to be expected. It's not so much a negative reaction, it's an uh-oh, like, oh my gosh, if it's this simple, what am I going to do with my life? See, wow, oh my gosh, it can be all over, but the path can be over right now. I structure my life like I'm going to do, you know, all this time, and I suddenly see, oh my gosh, I can literally, I can do it right this minute, this second. It's really simple. So that creates a reverberation through your nervous system because you're not sure what's next, what to expect, what to do with your life. Your whole schedule seems to just collapse. So it, depending on how one reacts to this, there will be either, you know, a negative reaction or more of a cool down reaction and a positive reaction later. So it's very important to not be in a hurry to grab this, you know, to do anything with it. Don't grab your clarity. Don't try to do anything with it. Very important. Just sit. Just sit. Quietly sit. That's why often in looking, inquiry, satsang, there'll be a satsang and then there'll be a time of just silence. Just silence. You're not trying to silence your mind, to tell you the truth. You are more just sitting quietly without feeling that you need to do anything. You don't need to go somewhere. You don't need to silence your mind. You don't need to make any achievements. You just no schedule, nothing on your mind. Just sit there quietly and let it sink in. Give it time to let the insights have time to grow roots. That just gives it some time. And notice the reverberation. The oh my gosh type of feeling. Like wow, the wow feeling, like wow. This is changing my future, my destiny. I don't know. Like right now I don't have a clue as to what the future holds really. From this standpoint, I don't know. So there's an adjustment to that. So it's important to give yourself the time to adjust to this. This is powerful medicine. This is super powerful medicine, really. Spiritual medicine. To be able to see that we can literally make that change this moment. And there's nothing standing in the way. And that we have the explanation for it. And we're able to do it. This kind of takes our breath away, really. And because what are we used to? We're used to spending our days in struggle. And to realize the struggle could be over this very moment, forever. It's like, whoa. You know, what am I going to do? I'm not used to that. I spent my whole life in struggle. You know, intense struggle. How can I live without struggle? Every day I'm used to wake up in the morning and it's Groundhog Day. You know, same Groundhog Day. My whole life just been Groundhog Day. Get up, oh my gosh, the same day all over again. It's like that. How do you look and say, oh, that won't happen anymore? Well, it might be a nice Groundhog Day. Wake up every day, feels completely refreshed and blissful every day. That's possible. So, but there won't be this struggle. Oh, I still got all these problems. I still feel all the tension. I feel insecure. All this, it's not there anymore. It's not at all. So it's like, uh-oh. So it's a shock. It's a shock. It's a shock. So you literally have to give yourself time to let the shock wear off. So it's important to let that happen. And so I keep continue chatting on, reinforcing it, and letting the shock wear off. There should be a cool down time in the videos, in any contemplation you're doing. There should be a cool down time. It's kind of like, oh my gosh, I have the answer. I've been searching for the answer my entire life, and now it's right in my hands. It's like that. You say, holy cow, I've got the answer right here. So what am I feeling? Shock. Feeling this type of shock. A little bit of disorientation. Sort of a not spatial temporal, not that functional disorientation, but a little bit of sort of psychological disorientation. It's like my psyche is, there's that third eye whomp again, but my psyche is don't really get a read on my psyche. What's my psyche like right now? I don't know. Unknown. I don't know. So when you're used to having your psyche be a certain way, this can be, you're not sure, like, well, you know, what's my psyche going to be like? I don't know. You probably won't have a psyche. I won't be able to say anything about it. Because in prepping for timelessness, you don't need a psyche. You don't need a personality. You don't need any of that. That's now you have overflowing bliss, peace of mind. You don't have a psyche anymore. So we can say goodbye, psyche. Getting used to saying goodbye to a psyche. that's what it feels like. It's like, wow, my psyche is departing. Auf Wiedersehen. But not until we meet again. I better say something different than that. Goodbye. Again, the boom. Goodbye, psyche. So, don't let that panic you. This is part of the purpose of these videos, is to help you out, show other people how it's done. It can be done. I'm just sitting in a very nice place, as you can see. There's nothing else going on around, although people come and go various times. I can always hit pause button. Very kind of sheltered, shaded, screened off, and wonderful day. I'm just sitting here. I don't have to function in any particular way right now after work. Everything is very simple, very basic. Life is simple. My life is very simple, very basic. There's nothing, no scheduling going on. It's just the same old every day. Get up, go to work, then rest on the weekends. And so I'm gonna hit pause here pretty soon. And just come home after work and do taping, and then look at YouTube in the evening. And maybe watch a baseball game, and that's it. It's not a complex life at all. Okay, hold on just a second. Be right back. Alright. And, so, for somehow the Holy Spirit has given me a very simple life, which is frustrating, because because I said, hey, how can I succeed in life because I'm not doing anything. I'm not networking with anybody. I just live the, every day is this Groundhog Day. It's the same. I don't go anywhere. I don't do anything. It's just been that way, you know, almost my entire life, really. It's because I can sort of experience my psyche, you know, no psyche, departing, and I say, well, you know, that's not a problem. What do I need my psyche for? Don't really need it, really. My functioning is so simple and basic. I don't really need a psyche, so I'm able to entertain these ideas, these concepts, these clarifications, and it doesn't feel threatening to me. But I'm saying that to you, the viewers, of course it's going to feel a little bit threatening unless you also have been prepared for it. And some have, and they can say, oh yeah, it's not a problem. I don't really need much of a psyche. I can kind of feel my psyche. It's not like it's dissolving or anything. It's just that I don't really have a read on it, one way or the other, of like, what am I feeling, or just whatever people say, that they're in touch with themselves, their feelings. They mean they're in touch with their psyche and all its complexities and subtleties and everything. But I would say I don't really have a sense of a psyche right now. It's, you know, what's my future going to be? I don't know. What am I going to do? I don't know. What are my plans? I don't know. It's basically, I don't know, I don't know, I don't know. There's no read. How am I going to be in the next minute? I don't know. So I don't know how I'm going to feel or react. So there's this kind of, there's nothing going on in my psyche that I'm aware of. Except kind of a reverberation. So the psyche has sort of lost its definition, as it were. You might say that. It's kind of become blurred. The psyche has become diffuse or blurred. It lost its definition. But do we really need a psyche to function, is the question. Do we really need a psyche to function just, you know, to eat food? Do we need a psyche to eat food, to drive, or, you know, do most things that we do? Do we really need that? Perhaps not. Do we need a psyche to chop wood and carry water? We do need a psyche to strive for success, be competitive and shrewd and all these struggles. We need a psyche for all the struggles. But as far as just a simple existence, do we really need a psyche for that? Probably not. Now, just overflowing bliss or perfect peace cannot be said to be a psyche. We would not define psyche in that way at all. And that yet there are those who have been in such a condition, who function here extraordinarily well. Not a problem, they're functioning. They could do all the basic stuff, you know, very smoothly, very clearly. But they didn't have a psyche. They were always just blissful, without any effort at all. So we're not trying to make the psyche blissful. We're simply allowing the psyche to depart, as it were. We're replacing the psyche with bliss, or we're replacing the prepping for time with the prepping for timelessness. So in the prepping for timelessness, there's no psyche. There's no need for any psyche. So for some reason, I've been put in the ideal position to be able to share this information and help ground it here. Because I don't feel threatened by it. Now, I used to, for sure. It's been a long, long struggle of severe struggles, confusions and fears and anxieties and all that. And but now I don't feel that. There's still a strain because I feel like this whole notion of the simplicity of it is, it's a shock. It is a shock. No matter how one prepares, when you see it, it's still shocking because, again, what do I do? How do I function? What was my life going to be like? There are those concerns. But what it is, you will still be prepping, so you'll fit in with the world in those terms. You'll be able to relate to other preppers, even though they're prepping for something else. You're still prepping, so you will be seen pretty normal, and you'll still be here, and everything will be pretty much the same. But your prepping will have a different quality to it, and people will notice that. They'll say, "Huh, you have an entirely, your prep is very different. How are you prepping for time?" You say, "I'm not prepping for time. That's why it's so different." And they'll say, it'll be puzzlement. They'll say, how can this help my prepping? How can you help my prepping?" I say, "I cannot. I can help you choose a different goal of prepping. But I can't help you in your prepping for time." And then some will move on and others will gravitate and say, I kind of dimly see that this is where I need to go to. This is the answer. Now, how circumstances arrange themselves, I don't know, but I've definitely been promised by those who have done this that somehow circumstances arrange themselves. So I just try not to worry about that, really. Because if you do, you go crazy. Because you can't figure it out. You pretty much have to go on faith, as far as that's concerned. That you will not be, just because you're not prepping for time, you won't be homeless in this world. Because you're still prepping, you're prepping for timelessness. So the circumstances that support prepping for timelessness will somehow arrange themselves. I don't know how, but they do. That's what we've been told. So just have faith in that. So right now, the circumstances have arranged themselves to help me bring this information, share this information with the world, which is part of my purpose for coming here. So I assume it will arrange itself to help to support prepping for timelessness. I think that's a reasonable assumption to make. Sharp in my neck there. Wow. There's just also this feeling there. So I would say that whatever happens, as far as something wonderful or beautiful or some sort of spiritual experience, etc., just simply say, "Okay, this is part of my prepping for timelessness." That's all you need to say. I'm not worried about trying to put it in any other context at this point. So I feel I have a steady, rock-steady context. That was my purpose in the world, is to bring in a rock-steady foundation. Because I felt the foundation in the world, spiritual foundations, were not really rock-steady at all. There are way too many holes and uncertainties about it. And really, the foundation work is the real work. It's the hard work, it's the real work. Most of the people in the world, they're thinking like, what kind of tile can I put in the kitchen? What kind of refrigerator am I going to put in there? What color am I going to paint this room? They're all interior decorators. The world is all interior decorators. They're not thinking at all about how am I going to build a rock steady foundation for this house? So when you look at my situation, there's no house to it. There's no house to it. So people say, well, there's nothing there, nothing to see here, let's move on. There's no house. But if you're really keen, you'll say, well, wait a minute. Yeah, there may not be a house yet, but look at the foundation. Let's check, look at this foundation. Oh my gosh, it's a completely rock steady foundation. You can build anything on that foundation. It's an amazing foundation. That's the hard work, that's the real work. That's the work where you get your work clothes on, your gloves and your hard hat, and you got the jackhammer, I mean, and you're just working in the tough, gritty, nitty gritty stuff of making this, putting this foundation on bedrock, on absolute pristine bedrock. And once that foundation is all set, then hey, anything at all can be built and it will last forever. So most people shopping around are shopping for houses. They go, oh, look at the pretty house. I like the trim. I like the paint job. I like the trim, the way that trimmed out there. And so, yeah, I like that one. But the real wise ones say, I'm looking for a foundation that will support, just perfectly be supportive, a perfectly supportive foundation. That's the one. Forget about the house. I can build a house easy. That's not the issue. The issue is the foundation. If the foundation isn't right, then your house is never going to be right. Building a house is a piece of cake, really. It really is. It's just a matter of cutting and nailing. And measuring, cutting, nailing. But the foundation, you got to get that right. That's a whole different thing. That's the hard part. So what we've been doing here is the hard part, the tough part, the part that enables us to... Any spiritual experience arises, just say, oh, okay, that's part of my prepping for timelessness. And just let it go. Don't even try to figure anything else out about it. Don't have to say, oh, try to put it into some context of other spiritual context. It's like, no, I just, whatever happens, I'm just going to say, this is part of my prepping for timelessness. Thank you, this is part of my prepping for timelessness. End of discussion. No mind whirling around trying to figure out how does this fit in, Oh, whatever. I'm not trying to fit it in with anything. It's just prepping. That's all. Just enjoy it. If suddenly vision opened up and I saw all these angels floating in the sky, I'd just say, okay, this is just prepping for timelessness. This is part of my prepping for timelessness. And just enjoy it. I wouldn't try to make anything of it. You don't need to make anything of it. Just enjoy it. As Ramana said, abide in it. He wasn't trying to make anything of it. See, he says, abide in it. Just enjoy it. Because it's prepping for timelessness. And what it really does is solves the continuity problem. And see, in this prepping for timelessness, we don't have to be creative as far as, oh, I see the angels now, I must compose a song or something. That's prepping for time. But in timelessness, there's no need for that sort of prepping. It's different prepping. It's simply, you just simply enjoy it. That's why you see those who are doing that, like Ramana. He's not out there painting and composing and dancing and trying to inspire everyone with forms of creativity. He's just abiding in it, enjoying it. That's the example, it's the right example. I've had some pretty amazing situations. I've been privy to like great artists, their situation and everything about that, and see it and say, okay, it is what it is, but I don't want that. I don't want that. I don't want to be a great artist. I don't have any desire for that. I don't have a abiding desire for that at all. I don't want to be known as a great artist. I've already been in another life. I've already been through that. Simply want to set the example for how to get free of this nightmare of a simulation of time. That's what we really want. We want that more than we want great art. I tell you that for sure. We want freedom from this nightmare much more than we want great art. Much more. And people say, oh, we can't. We have it all, have it all, have it all. Well, when you try to have it all, your answers are not clear enough. We need to clear this up. We need to know for sure. Ananda Maimon didn't produce any art. She never even wrote a book. She never wrote it all. I think she wrote like her sister tried to sign her name once and scrawled some few words once or something. But other than that, nothing. She didn't build anything. Didn't compose anything, really. Well, she may have had gave a couple expressions of spiritual poetry or something a few times, but she never expressed any desire to be an artist or to anchor some sort of great forms of creativity or cleverness or beauty in this world at all. No, she's overflowing bliss, saying this is, you can choose this as prepping for timelessness. You can abide in this overflowing bliss and perfect peace of mind. And she said, that is the goal. That is the goal. Not trying to tap into some higher levels of consciousness so you can write books of poetry. You know, no. Forget it. So of course, when you tap into this prepping for timelessness, you may experience it's very sublime. The experience may become very sublime, and you think, oh my God, if I could just translate this sublimity of this into music, I would be hailed as the greatest composer in history. You know, so, and you have to just say, forget it. No. And you think, oh my gosh, this is my one chance. I can be the greatest composer in history, or the greatest artist. I paint this, I'd be the greatest painter in history, or whatever, greatest poet ever. I can inspire the world, you know. I'd go down in history, in the history books. Truth is, I've already gone down in the history books, previous life, and let me tell you, it's nothing. It's nothing but a drag, really. It really is. Didn't save me from suffering one bit, not one bit. Just a burden. Plenty of people have gone down in the history books. Many. And it's not worth anything. People say, oh, I'd do anything to at least have some, be able to have some beautiful art, to be able to give people art, and I could say, look what I've done, I've helped people's lives, or something like that. No, you have not helped them at all free themselves from this, you know, exchange prepping. In fact, it made things worse, because what happens is when you get that stuff, it's like a drug that kind of, you try to ease the pain of prepping for time. So you say, oh, I can prep for time a little longer because I'm not in suffering so bad. I can listen to George Jones and not feel so bad about my prepping for time. I can keep going. So in that regard, it doesn't help at all. And as far as the person, you know, producing that great artwork and stuff, usually they're miserable. I wasn't happy. And like George Jones, he wasn't, he was bewildered by it all. He really didn't quite believe it, actually, of all this, you know, success and songs and everything. In my opinion, you know, there's never been a greater singer to ever walk the earth. And he didn't see that. He is perplexed by it and says, you know, how did this happen to me? I don't know. His life was very tough and difficult and stressful and chaotic and whoosh, like, whoa. You know, what was that? So, you know, he didn't get free from time, prepping for time. And people that stood and they say, oh boy, I really relate to the suffering of time. Yeah. But it doesn't free you from it. So it's art is overrated. Let me tell you this. It is way overrated. Drastically overrated. As someone who was an extreme artist at one point, I can tell you, you know, those who bypass that are the wise ones. Really are the wise ones. Because the sublimity of prepping for timelessness is in what it's prepping for. So when you try to put that into time, it's how can you put it? What word can you use? It's corrupt. There's a feeling of corruption there, you know. It's not genuine. There's a lack of sincerity. It's flat. It doesn't translate. It doesn't translate well at all. It does not. So there's a sort of a feeling of flat tiredness, you know. Yeah, it's a beautiful tire, but it's flat. It's kind of like that. It's like that. There's this incredible painting here. And you look at it and say, oh God, that's unbelievable painting, you know. And then you kind of look around, you see it's in a frame on some canvas, and the painting is sitting in a room, and the room's in a house, and the house is in the yard, and the concrete's breaking up in the yard, and the bricks are buckling, and you know, it's raining out, it's cold, it's windy, the leaves are falling, that tree is dying, and I'm pinched for money. I've got an ulcer, you know, I've got all these problems, the family problems, and all that. And you say, whoa, you know, it's flat. That beautiful painting is kind of like a flat tire. I've got a beautiful bike, but it's got flat tires. And I can't pump them up. It's got a leak. You pump it up, it won't hold it. Won't hold the air, won't hold the pressure. So that's what art is like in this prepping for time. It kind of leaves you like, you know, how you drink a soft drink. And while you're drinking, it's really sweet and really nice. Ah, that's great. And then afterwards, you feel kind of like, there's this kind of aftertaste, and you don't feel good. You don't feel good. You say, I need to drink some more. It's just leaving aftertaste. It's not good. It's like that. We get a wistful feeling, beautiful art. I mean, I've spent my life immersed in beautiful art of all kinds, and it didn't do it. It didn't work. It didn't work. It left me just feeling frustrated, depressed, feeling like, this just doesn't, it's not good enough. It's just not what I really need or want. It is ineffectual. But it's a temporary, it's like a drug. Yeah, but why be a drug pusher is the question. You might be a really great drug pushers. Hey, this stuff is even better, but it's still a drug. It's still a drug. Now, some people get into being really beautiful. A lot of people, actually. Dressing beautifully, making them made up in their hair, and their appearance, and their jewelry, and how they look, or whatever. Just smelling great. You know, they present the body beautiful, and just like, and then that's like a drug. People see that and say, that's really, wow, that's beautiful, wow, you know, like that. And it but that too has a very flat feeling to it. Temporary drug, little hit of that, and you kind of don't feel quite so miserable maybe for a little while. People look at glossy magazines of beautiful people. All these magazines are full of all these beautiful people, all these beautiful things. Photography can make things look really, really beautiful. But again, there's something flat tire-ish about that. And we know it, we know it. My gosh, I have consumed so much of all the beauty of the world, and leaves you feeling empty, it leaves you feeling, the hunger is not appeased. Hunger is not appeased, it's still there. And if you're not careful, you get into big trouble, like a meth addict. You have all this energy and you don't sleep, and you go, and you feel like you're a super person. And then later on, you look at yourself and you're burned out like a corpse. So It's better to accept what's being said here. It is simply accept that this is my prepping. This is, abiding in this is my prepping for timelessness. And abiding is part of it. Okay, let me say this very strongly and forcefully. Abiding in it without doing anything about it is part of the prepping for timelessness. In other words, you don't have to do anything about the sublimity that you're experiencing. You don't have to do anything about it. That's part of the prep. If you start trying to do something about it, then you're at counter purpose, at cross purposes to the prep. If you say, oh my God, I've got to run down to the store and buy some paints and start painting, that's at counter purposes. Say, no. You're supposed to just sit. Just sit quietly. Just sit peacefully. Or just be at peace and just enjoy it. Just enjoy it. It's possible at some point you might write a book. It's possible. If that comes up as something that is indicated or something. But you don't have to run right out and say, I gotta get this down, I gotta write it down. No, just say, no, this sublimity will remain with me because it's part of my prep. Or it might become even better. So it will remain. It's not gonna flee from you. So there's no worries there. Don't worry as to how to grab a hold of it. No, it will remain. It will be steady. It will be with you. It's your prepping for timelessness. Or it gets even better. It deepens. So don't be concerned. It will deepen. It will get better. And it won't leave you because you didn't write a song about it. Okay? Or wrote a book about it. It won't leave you because you don't proclaim it to the world. It won't leave you. It's your prep. How can it leave? It's prepping for timelessness. That's the idea. So it can't go anywhere. It can't leave. It doesn't expect you to design some jewelry in honor of it. Build a monument, build a house, do something in honor of it, to honor it, to glorify it. It's not asking you to glorify it. It's asking you to abide in it. So there should be, in one who has chosen to prep for timelessness, there must be, as I call, the vibrancy of certainty, the certain vibrancy, sublimity to the situation. That has to be there. Whether it's this great calm, but in that there will be this feeling of an epic calm, something really epic is there. Something very profound, very sublime. You notice it. You notice it. You say, whoa. It's like, wow, let me just sit down here. I better sit here. Like, what in the world? There's something here that is just profound, really profound. That would be the reaction to those who have not yet, understand what's going on. To the one who's in this condition, they're relaxed and just enjoying it. They're not feeling like it's too much, too intense or anything. They're just smiling and just enjoying it. But the others will see it like this is, there is an enormous vibrancy. Not an energetic vibrancy necessarily, but something that is just takes your breath away. Very sublime. First time I saw a video of Anandamayi, and even a picture, but especially a video, I was stopped in my tracks, like frozen in my tracks. That very instant, completely just stopped in my tracks. And I said, holy cow, what is that? That was my question, what is that? That's what I said, what is it? I don't say, who is this? I said, what is that? Normally you'd say, who is that, right? No, that was not my reaction at all. My reaction is, what is that? Oh, I said, oh my God, what is that? And then I said, that's Christ. I mean, that's my reaction. I said, what is that? And I realized that's Christ. I mean, that is perfect certitude. that is abiding. That is everything and nothing abiding and everything and nothing. Now that was a very rare case, but to bring it back to its simplest component, I said, what is that? What is that? Meaning, there's something incredible, profound and sublime, just come from the video, just like stop me in my tracks, you know. So that's an extreme case, but in any case, there will be this feeling like, wow, be almost beyond wow. Something your psyche just, you know, you don't feel like a psyche. There's no psyche anymore because your psyche doesn't have any idea. Like, it's like, well, there's no psyche there. That's also what I saw in her. I said, in that situation, on my mind, I said, there's no psyche there. There's no person there. There's nobody there. It was obvious to me that there's nobody there. There's no person. There's no psyche at all. So how's this body moving? How's it functioning? I saw it, felt it, like, holy cow, this is a body moving there, but there's nobody there. So it's like, what? Very amazing, very amazing. Also, some of those looks of Ramana Maharshi, you just say, what in the world, you know? Wow, what is that that is looking at me? What is it that's looking at me? It's like the sublime itself is looking at me. It's not a person looking at me. The same with the non-mind. There's no person looking at you there. It's not a person. It's not a she. It's not a person at all. It's no psyche. There's no persona looking at me. There's something else is looking at me. What is it? It's like, wow. But that something else loves me. You know, loves what it's looking at. I don't know what they see in me, but they really love it. You know, it's like they're just saying, so beautiful. You can tell whatever they're looking at is so beautiful. It is so sublime. Sublime beyond anything in this world, for sure. There's no way you could look at anything in this world and have the same look that Ramana has. No way. He is looking at something else that is so sublime and beautiful and peaceful that it's just, you know, wow. So it's not a psyche that's looking at you. So obviously, it gives you a kind of like a wake-up call. Huh? And they're just sitting there, you know, they're just enjoying it. They're not doing anything about it. They're not saying, hey, I need to build a church. I need to start this movement. I have to do this, I have to do that. No, just enjoying it, sitting there enjoying it. That's all. So that's the lineage I come from. I come from that lineage of Jesus, Ananda Mahima, Ramana Maharshi, the examples that they set. Showcasing. That's what I aim for. That's what I aim for. Now, you may say, well, if you're just sitting there, just abiding in it, nothing's going to happen. Not true, because everybody that sees you is going to be stopped in their tracks. And they're going to say, holy cow, what is that? What is that? And those who are, you know, the seed is ready to sprout, will sprout, start sprouting, and roots will start going down, the plant will start growing, the plant of clarity will start growing. And it just happens like that. Nothing even needs to be said. Nothing needs to be said. Now, they might run around and say, we need to build a church, we need to build an ashram, we need to publish books, we need to do this, blah, 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 blah. You know, what can you do? You know, for a while, then they're doing, they're still into doing, thinking that, you know, not being clear about what's going on. But gradually that subsides. Gradually it subsides. Until they feel, oh, I can just sit here, I don't really need to do anything. And they gradually realize this is the answer. It's prepping for timelessness. It's not prepping for time. We're not trying to inspire people to succeed in prepping for time. That is lunacy. Prepping to accomplish the impossible is lunacy. And of course, incomplete, the death of spirit is impossible. Whereas timelessness is saying that the death of spirit is impossible. Incompleteness is impossible and possible. The prepping is oh, this is right on, even though timelessness too is an imaginary state. Because reality is neither time nor timeless. It's neither everything nor nothing. It is beyond. It's beyond duality. But we don't need to worry about that. We can maintain a sense of duality, as it were, but prep for non-duality, prep for timelessness. Use timelessness as a symbol for what is beyond all symbols. So we use a symbol that stands for what is has no symbol, be completely beyond symbolization. All right, and prep for that symbol. All right, so hopefully that is clear. We prep for that symbol, timelessness. It stands for what is beyond all symbols entirely. What symbol could symbolize everything and nothing? At that point, symbols utterly fail, right? Completely fail. You can make a symbol for everything, and you can make a symbol for nothing, but can you really make a meaningful symbol for everything and nothing as one? It again, another flat tire. It just doesn't work. So go beyond symbols, as it were. Prep to go beyond symbols. That's another way of putting it. A Course in Miracles says, prep to go beyond words. It's saying the same thing, just slightly different language usage, but prep to go beyond words means prep to go beyond symbols, and therefore you use one symbol, the symbol timelessness, as it were, and prep for that, prepare to step into that symbol, as it were. You can't really step into symbols, right? Nothing to step into, it's flat. No real depth to it, but it's very useful to use the symbol of timelessness, to prep to step into timelessness. Hopefully I'll post this video. I did another one before this, it's a couple hour video. I might render it and put it on put a link to it or something for those who want to watch. It gets into a lot of the world and the problems of the world and how things are so going to be so terrible. But I felt like, you know, maybe it's more important not to get into that. This kind of talk is more important, actually. It's better. Yeah, it's way better. It saves so much more time. This has been a good one. I've enjoyed doing this one. I'm starting to get hunger. I can see why. Dinner time. Retreats are good in that you commit and say there can be three, you know, several days, whatever, where all you're going to do is inquiry. And then you're going to have a day of winding down and processing it before you leave. So you're not even thinking about your worldly schedule. You're supposed to drop your worldly schedule. Drop your phone, no worldly schedule. Nothing to do, nowhere to go, so much to, you know. And you just can feel this, like, I don't need a psyche to function. I don't really need to function. Just bare minimum. I can sit, I can drink water, eat something. That's all I need to do. Here, I don't need any other, no mind games, no office politics. Drop all that stuff, you know. Don't need to be super mom, super dad, super parent. You don't need to be super anything. And that is actually the most helpful thing. You don't even need to be super sannyasi, super devotee, super meditator, super prayer, if that's a word, I don't know what you, super supplicant. Super in love, super anything. You don't need to be super anything. Don't forget about being super anything. Just be present and without feeling like you need to. Just be abiding in where you're at. Just that. Just be with it. Not like, hey, who's with it more than someone else is with it? No. Don't even care about that. Just feel like you don't need to be not with it. You know, there's no reason not to be with it. That's a better way to look at it. There's no reason not to be with it. I'll just hang out. Just hang out with it. Just hang out. And don't worry about being super functional yet. Just, you know, you can just sit. And don't try to be relaxed. Just let the reverberation happen. And this is just like a conducive to clarity. It's not clarity in itself. You know, just sitting relaxed is not clarity in itself, actually. What it does is it enables these amazing clarifications to come and reverberate and not cause you to panic. That's really what it's good for. Because what we're after is the prepping for timelessness. And that is sublime. That is sublime. It is not just merely sitting quietly. I'm breathing nicely, steady breath. I'm relaxed. I'm imagining a beautiful flower. That is not what we're after. What we're after is the prepping for timelessness is bound to be very sublime and a blanket type of feeling. A steady, unperturbed kind of solemnity that is just, quite something. It's bound to be that. So this other stuff is really for the purpose of centering yourself in such a way that when these insights and clarifications come, you don't feel freaked out by them. You don't feel freaked out by not feeling a psyche, so much of a psyche. Like the psyche is suddenly becomes very blurred. You say, whoa, I don't need a psyche. You know, whoa. If you're centered and calm, centered, or just centered, or feeling okay with about where, you know, not having to do too much, and then you can say, oh, I don't have a psyche. It's very blurred. Okay. No big deal. It's fine. I can live with that. Just now, let me keep going on with the clarification. Like that. That's what it's for. It's a means to an end. It's not an end in itself. So you're not trying to master meditation. You're not trying to master anything. Not trying to be the master of anything. You're not trying to be an adept at all. The goal is to exchange simulations. So your simulation of timelessness, you're prepping for timelessness. That's the goal. And then the prepping automatically goes along with the purpose of it. Timelessness automatically leads sublime. And you just abide in it. So don't be too focused on how am I doing with my meditation? How am I doing? As long as the clarifications are coming and it's coming more and more simple and you see, all I have to do is make this exchange. I see it's so simple, I can do it right now. As long as you're starting to move that way, then you're succeeding. That's all that counts. You don't have to measure your meditation or anything. You're succeeding. You're absolutely succeeding. Moving towards that moment of deciding, okay, I'm setting down the goal of time for the goal of timelessness. I'm setting down my prep for time, for my prep for timelessness, and I decide I'm going to do that, and that's it. That's what you're simply moving towards that. So don't worry about taking measurements. Don't measure. Try to measure your progress, like, how is my meditation? How is my chanting? How is my devotion? How is this? How is it? No. Forget it. Keep aiming for the insights. Keep aiming for the clarity. Okay? And give it some time. Be sure to give it some time. All right, so about the end of this one, I'll cool down a little bit here. Just keep cooling down. What do you do, cool down? What I'm doing right now is sort of looking around at surroundings a little bit. I don't have any methodology to what I do. Because as soon as this methodology comes in, I find that people start practicing. They become practitioners. You want to avoid being a practitioner. Now, everybody has their own little way. Some might stretch this way or stretch that way. I don't really do that. I just kind of say, well, you know, when I feel ready to get up, I get up. Just let it happen. Others will want to have some kind of their little quirks of how they do it, their methodology. But again, don't become a practitioner. Do not become a practitioner. That really puts the brakes on. I might just be aware of the atmosphere here. And at some point, your mind will start to re-engage with the world. It will just naturally start to re-engage with, you know, as a crow, you know, yelling over there. And you will feel it. Don't force the re-engagement. You will feel it. Maybe hunger pains will help the re-engagement. So, for me, it's like Tim Lincecum is pitching tonight. I gotta see what he's gonna do. Is he gonna implode again? Or will he suddenly capture his Cy Young form? Recatcher. The ongoing saga of Tim Lincecum. The transcendent artist on the mound who has suddenly gone into his film noir mode, the dark mode. He has lost his... he's a mad artist right now. So we can chat about the weather. That's another way of re-engaging. Weather is like darn near perfect here. It's funny how the weather here is syncing up with the work week. It is a bizarre thing. During the work week, it goes down into the high 70s with a soft breeze. I mean, it's just like perfect, beautiful. During the weekends, poof, goes up into the 90s. So that is going to happen again this week. So I say, that's great. That's great. Glorious soft evening here. We're ridiculously spoiled. Don't be in a hurry. Don't be in a hurry. Don't force it. You'll get your visual engagement comes to you. Usually when I'm talking, I don't have really a visual engagement with anything. Everything's there, but I'm not focused on it really. There's no visual engagement there. There's very little engagement with the world when I'm sharing these insights and little, but I'm used to that. If I had to function, of course I could function like that, no problem. But there's just sort of a soft, diffuse non-engagement with everything. It's subtle. So if I had to leap into action, I could, no problem. But it would be a little jarring, it might cause a sort of jarring feeling. So it's better to have a smooth, gentle segue into getting back into all the prepping for time. Which is the world. It's not coming back at this point very strongly. That's why I'm still sitting here. because the insights were so strong. Incredible stuff. It rocks me as much as it rocks the viewer, you know. This stuff is not stuff that I've, you know, I maybe saw it from a distance a bit, but getting up close, you get up close to it, and it's like, wow, huh, very strong. Okay. Picking a lot of vegetables now, baskets full of vegetables. All different kinds of squash. Zucchini, yellow scallop squash, white scallop squash, mixed scallop squash. It's kind of got a zucchini-like top. Yellow crookneck squash of several varieties. I'm picking three types of cherry tomatoes at this point. Yellow pear cherry, small cherry, larger cherry. I'm picking many types of peppers now. The name of them escapes me. The Apache, the miniature Thai pepper, the Inferno pepper. I picked a Fresno pepper, and another one, I can't remember the name of it, but it's supposed to be hot, but it's not, because it's still kind of greenish. It hasn't matured yet. But the little Thai pepper is a, boof, man, that gives you a pop. I'm telling you, I had to hit the corn chips and milk on that one several times. it wakes you up, and it's still green. You know, it's still green. So there's a lot of peppers coming out of the jalapenos. I think there's some on there. I picked bell pepper today. Nice bell pepper. So cucumbers coming in, lemon cucumbers, the big green cucumbers, which are absolutely delicious. I mean, they're just, you know, quality stuff you'd serve at a restaurant. All these vegetables are high quality. Well, you'd serve it completely organic, you'd serve it at a restaurant. I mean, the flavor of them is just off the charts. So I go out in the morning and I, you know, collect a basket of vegetables right now, and pretty soon one early girl tomato is ready to pick. It's a big, you know, 2.5-3 inch juicy red tomato. It's ready June 4th. It's ready to eat. I just don't want to pick it. It looks so beautiful on the vine. There's a big cluster of 7 early girl tomatoes that just look fabulous, absolutely wonderful. So all these vegetables are just going to keep flooding in. So I can always spend some time to go out there and just wander around picking these vegetables. It's fun. And when the peppers really start coming in, that's going to be something, because peppers can be quite prolific. These Apache pepper plants I have, they're just blowing up. It is something else. I mean, some of these pepper plants are just going to produce an incredible amount of peppers. I have my ghost peppers. I have actually 7 ghost peppers. One big pot, I have 6 of them, and it's just going to be a massive bush of ghost peppers, which are beautiful to see on the plant, actually. The vibrancy of the red, you just, oh my gosh, look at those peppers. So it's going to be fun. This third eye thing is still, I'm still getting this stuff going on here. I don't know what it is. All right, so we're getting a little more engaged. You see how I'm able to kind of try and work myself into engagement. When you've had a very deep looking, you may have to spend some effort into getting yourself re-engaged with the world. And the garden is one way, I think, for me to engage with the world, tie in those tomato plants. If the tomato plants are gone, this is, you know, what do you call it? I mean, some, they're on steroids. The tomato plants are on steroids. There's no question about it. The steroid is chicken manure, and, you know, they're incredible. They're like over 7 feet tall, and width is, you know, 7 feet wide, 7 feet tall. I mean, they're just skyscrapers. And I have to keep tying them up. Every day's a battle. They're going to fall over the place. They've just gone crazy. All right, so see what's for dinner. Something, I don't know what. I have no idea at this point. but something will happen. I'll get something. All right, very great. This is a really, really profound one, because we're at the exchange point, really. We're at the point of exchange, and we see what's in one hand, and we see what's in the other, and we say, oh my gosh, that's very profound. All right, we'll wrap this one up, see if I can render it, upload it, edit it, process it, get it out to you, like a baker, you know, baking these videos. And very great. We'll see how it goes from here on.